Hey, family, friends, children of God, we love you. We are so happy to be with you. It is an absolute pleasure to open up the Word of God with you. For many years, I was a chef, and one of my favorite things is cooking a big meal and inviting family and friends over, and even people in my restaurant. After a number of years, they would come in and I'd cook for them. And after I was done, I would sit down at the table and we would just eat together and celebrate each other's friendship and their love and good talk and conversation and tell stories and be together and share the good things that was going on in our life. And that's my definition of church. We open up the Word together. We have the meal of God's Word. And then afterwards, we talk and we fellowship and we share about all the good things that God is doing in our lives. So I love to meet with you. It is February. We are having live services. We're going to have at least two a week. We probably will have a midweek at my house. And just, you know, we're just so excited that we can begin to meet again, that we could just fellowship with one another, that we can hang out, that we could talk. We were created for companionship. We were created for friendship. And one of the greatest friendships you can have in the world is a friendship with God. And we're going to be talking a little bit about that today. And so let's just pray before we begin. Father, we just thank you that you want us to have a friendship with you. God, I'm a father, and the greatest delight in my life is to have a friendship with my children. And God, I thank you that you don't want your children to be strangers, to feel they cannot come to you, to ask you, to speak to you, to unburden themselves, to receive wisdom from you. I pray today that people will come to you and approach you as Father today. One of the great things that Jesus taught, open our hearts to see you as our Father, to delight in you as our Father, and to know that you are good. Good morning. Good morning. Do you believe it's February? I'm glad. I just want to get through the winter. I'm not a winter guy. I have lots of friends who snowboard and ski and shushing, cross-country skiing, I call it shushing, because when you go, it makes a shushing sound. And I like the seasons and I like the weather, but I'm kind of a summer guy. I like the warm weather. I like to be warm. But you know, there are seasons in life, and I'm just very, very excited. Once February is gone, you know, we start to see the daylight of spring. And spring always reminds me of new life and all the things that seem to be hidden under the ice and the hard ground. The sun begins to warm and things begin to break through. I almost feel like knowing God is like that. His love warms us, and the seeds that he's put on us over the years begin to break through the soil of earth and of our lives and of our flesh, and we blossom and bloom in all the colors and all the beauty that God has put in us. And God has put a lot in you. I want to remind you of that today. God has put a lot in you. God is still investing in you. You are a child of God. We, as a family, God is always investing in us. I'm investing in my children. My children are investing in me. That's what we do. That's what we do. We pour our love into each other, our wisdom into each other, the life lessons that we learn. That's church. Church is just, it's just a group of people pouring their life lessons into one another so that we can be successful and stand as successful people. So it's very, very powerful. So we started a series on prayer, and last week I just talked about some practical basics of prayer. I want to talk a little bit more about the basics of prayer. I want to go back to a particular scripture that I want to share with you. Jesus shared this passage of scripture in Matthew 6, verse 5. It says, "And when you come before God, don't turn that into a theatrical production. All these people are making a regular show out of their prayers, hoping for 15 minutes of fame. Do you think God sits in a box seat?" This is the message. I love it. Here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God. Wow, that's so beautiful. And you will begin to sense His grace. You know, we pray because we desperately need God's intervention, whether by His wisdom or by His power, because we want eternal life, because we are more than the earth, and we are more than our flesh. We are promised eternity. We are promised heaven. We're promised eternal life. No matter how much you own, how smart you are, how powerful, everything that you have going for you on this earth, let me tell you something. The greatest thing you could gain is heaven. What does it profit a man if he gained the whole world and lose his soul? So I really love this. So we pray because we need God's intervention. We pray because God's will is our salvation, our deliverance, and the promises of blessing are fulfilled. I there are times where situations in life get over my head and bigger than I can handle, and God's blessings are promised. And last, God's glorified. Answer prayer because of His will, His goodness and power are seen. So God loves to answer prayer because His goodness and His will are seen. But what's the ground? What's the basics? Where do we start from this thing to be able to talk to God? And I don't know about you, if you've ever developed a friendship with somebody or a relationship with somebody, it is my hope, if you found somebody and you're getting married, I hope the first foundation of that relationship of marriage was a friendship. We all need friends. I mean, we tell our secrets to our friends. We share our life with our friends. We celebrate with friends. We enjoy friends. And of course, friends and family, sometimes your extended family or your family becomes extended by the friendships that you have. It's great when families meet together with other families and all of a sudden you become like one big family. Again, that's the kingdom of God. But God wants to begin everything with a relationship with you. To God, that's the core of why Jesus died, came to the earth. There was a strange relationship. People walked away from God. People doubted God. People didn't know God's will. People went their own way, and kind of bad things began to happen. Calamities began to fill the earth, and consequences started to overwhelm people. And then people started to call out to God, "Hey, God, help me." And part of that was God said, "I will answer, but you have to change. Position yourself." There's just times where you have to position yourself for the blessing. Get rid of those things that bring the consequences. Surrender your life to God. Walk in His will. And then when you pray for His will, He'll bring it. You know, God wants to trust you with the many blessings that He wants to give you. There are many, many blessings that God wants to give you, but He needs to trust you. So that's what a relationship is. It begins with trust, where God is building a trust, a relationship with you, where He can give you His best blessings because He knows they won't be used or abused. And so it's beautiful. So let's start. Let's begin. And at the end of this broadcast, we're going to pray with you to start that relationship with God. Maybe you already have one. Sometimes it falls by the wayside. Sometimes my relationship gets weak. A couple of weeks ago, I had to call somebody that I hadn't spoke to in a while because I just missed them. I don't want my relationship to go by the wayside. I keep connecting. It's why we come to church. It's why we pray. It's why we worship. We want to keep connecting with God. We want that friendship to be red hot. We want to enjoy God's friendship. I believe God, spending time with God, is vastly enjoyable to me. It's not like it's a burden or it's a chore. I try to give God my love and my attention, and He always I always leave his presence with something wonderful, some kind of blessing. So it's just, you know, I think about my relationship with God, like my other relationships that I have in this world. They bless me so much. They warm my heart. I receive their love. Great conversation, great wisdom, great fellowship, great sharing of our lives. It's very, very powerful. I know God created man because he wanted to share the good life that he had with us. That's his original intent. It will never change. And Jesus Christ came to restore that relationship so God could share his life. God's original intent, no matter how much evil tries to sidetrack it, it will not win. God's original intent will triumph. If I was the devil, I'd pull my hair out and throw myself down because you're not going to win. God's original intent, he's sovereign. He's all powerful. It will never change. His blessings for you are on the way. That's what it means that God is sovereign. His blessings for you are on the way. So prayer begins first with a relationship with God. Prayer is a journey of two friends. I was reading the other day on the road to Emmaus, the disciples. They didn't understand Jesus being crucified and being buried. And two friends discovered that the tomb was empty and angels were there, and they didn't know what this all meant. And Jesus walked 7 miles with them. Jesus walked 7 miles with them to explain everything that happened. And when they broke bread, they recognized them. It's so amazing that the deeper our fellowship with God, the deeper will be our meals, the more satisfied we'll be, the more we will understand God and be able to know that that he's on our side and that he is with us. So scripture says, beautiful scripture in the book of Amos 3:3, it says, except to agree, how can they walk together? So a friendship, sooner or later, you have to have things in common. In the church, we use a word called fellowship. It literally means to have in common. I mean, why do we come to church? We have in common Jesus Christ. We have in common God's word. We have in common that God is good. We have in common that God is our Father. We have in common that Jesus is Lord. We have so many things in common. It's so beautiful to have things in common. So my friendship with God is to learn more and more what I have in common with him. So the things that I don't have in common with him, I let fall away because I know they're not good for me. I know they won't feed my soul. They won't keep me strong. They won't prepare me for the next phase of my life, which is to leave this body and spend eternity with him. So there's things that are of utmost importance. That has got to be our focus, and it's eternity. Too many of us are time sensitive. In other words, we're wasting time here with so many things, but you were created for eternity. Don't forget that. This relationship is not one that starts here on earth and ends on earth. No, this friendship of God, it's been promised to stretch into eternity. It's why we can pray, because we pray for eternal things, God's original intent, things that will never change, things that will never be shaken. There's things that God told us to pray for that he will do, that nothing can stop it. So it's beautiful, except to be agreed. The Bible says he spoke to Moses and Abraham as to a friend. As to a friend. So God considered Moses and Abraham his friend. I'd like to be a friend of God. I'd like to be a friend of God. God tells his best secrets to his friends. I want to be a friend of God. I really do. In essence, let us become the trusted friend of God. I mean, that's, you know, when you pray and God is truly your father and your friend, you have so much confidence at the end of your prayer that prayer is answered because you know each other as two friends. I have so much confidence in certain friends that I know that when I say something to them, that they will answer my request. They'll be there. They'll be faithful for me. They'll help me. They'll guide me. They'll strengthen me. They'll be with me. It's the same thing in the realm of heaven. Things do not change. So many things on earth are just a picture of the greater capacity of our spirit man to be able to have friendship. We can have friendship with an eternal God, a God with unlimited wisdom and power. And we can enjoy that because God loves us. We are his friend. Can I tell you something? God loves spending as much time with you as you do with him. And I pray that you would believe that God wants to spend time with you. So God tells his best secrets to his friend. Friendship takes time to grow. I've been a Christian well over 30 years now, and friendship takes time to grow. And we grow together by knowing each other's minds and hearts, and that's what the Bible is about. You know, I once received a letter from a friend that I hadn't seen in a while. And when he wrote me that letter, it was like we were sitting in the same living room talking and communing and fellowshipping. The other day I called somebody and it was like we're in each other's presence. That's what the Bible is. It's God's letter to you. It's God's phone call to you. As soon as you begin to read that word, the communion begins between you and God. It's very, very powerful. God ordained that word to be alive. God ordained that word for communion, for us to have communion. We have served a God of compassion. Last week I shared this. I want to just share it again just really quickly. Prayer in its simplest form is talking to God and burdening ourselves. Some of the best prayers in the Bible are people who just pour their hearts out to God. I want to read you something because some people think, well, God doesn't understand. God's up there. He doesn't know. You know, the reason that Jesus became a man was to become like us in every way. And we're going to read something amazing. This is in Hebrews 4. We're going to begin with the 14th verse. It says, insomuch then, as we believers have a great high priest. That's like having a lawyer on your side that makes sure that everything that belongs to you comes to you. So that's what it is. It's like someone who knows somebody big, powerful, and important goes into the room before you and says, this guy is my friend. Everything that you would give to me, I want you to give to them. And they say, okay, because they're your friend, they're my friend. That's kind of what happened with Jesus. That's kind of what the cross and the resurrection was all about. That we could walk into the throne room of God. And because we're friends with Jesus, the Father is friends with us. My friend used to tell a joke. He said, when I was a kid, nobody would play with me. So my father tied a lamb chop around my neck for the dog to play with me. Well, I got news for Jesus is your lamb chop. God the Father finds you lovely because you're friends with his Son. God the Father finds you lovely because you love the Lord of his kingdom, the Savior of the world. You love what Jesus did for you. You love the destiny that God has prepared for you. You love the goodness of God. You love the character of God. God delights to meet with you. Prayer is a time to delight in the meeting of God and you. You and God. Sorry about that backwards. So the great high priest who has already ascended, passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession of faith and cling tenaciously to absolute trust in him. So, you know, things are going to look bad. But the Bible said to hold fast that he's your high priest. Hold fast that God is bringing the promises and the covenants to you. Hold fast that what Jesus did on the cross, that his work was accepted by God to bring you the answers, because you know Jesus, God knows you, and you're walking in the favor of God. The Bible, I mean, literally talks about being clothed with Christ. It's almost like when we walk in the room during prayer, it's like walking into the throne room during prayer, our spirit man, and we look like Jesus, we smell like Jesus, we talk like Jesus, and the Father goes, oh, this guy is so close to Jesus, I'm going to do for him what I would do for Jesus. Just incredible. Absolute trust in him. Absolute trust in him as Savior. So he saved us from all the things that we're praying about. He wants to save us from the things that are in our lives that might be troublesome. And also, you know, he just wants to give us peace and joy. Satisfy, fulfill. That's who he is. For we do not have a high priest. Now here's the thing. Who is unable to sympathize and understand our weaknesses and temptations. But one who has been tempted exactly knowing how it feels to be human in every respect as we are, yet without committing sin. So God knows who you are. He knows your good, the bad, the ugly. He knows everything about you. But as a great high priest, he sympathizes with you. He's been in the world. He was tired. He was hungry. He fell asleep. He was rejected. He, oh my goodness, was frustrated. Jesus experienced our humanity, so powerful, but yet he did not sin. And, you know, he understands what it's like to be in the world, to be in this place, to be under sometimes the power of evil, to be under sometimes the weaknesses of our own heart and mind, the ignorance. We hardly know God or what he wants or how to receive from God. All these shortcomings, Jesus came to shore them up. Jesus came to shore them up. Jesus came, you know, to bring an end to anything that would separate us from God or that would make us feel like we couldn't go to God. He sympathizes with us. He sympathizes. He feels what you feel. He knows what you're going through. And when he answers the prayer, it's because he understands you. I love this. Therefore, let us with privilege approach the throne of grace. So what is heaven? What is the throne that God sits on? It's the throne of God's favor, unearned. Unearned. The only reason why that you can pray in faith is because you believe that God will give it to you because you are his, you belong to him, you love him, and Jesus is your Lord. Not because you're good, because you tried, because you worked hard, because you gave to the poor, because you struggled to start. No, God does it because you're in Christ. God does this. Nothing you have to earn. There's nothing you have to do. God doesn't answer prayer because you jump through hoops. Prayers are answered by faith because of what Jesus has done. You pray from a favored position, from a forgiven position. It's amazing. It is amazing what this Jesus has done for us. So we approach a throne of grace, God's gracious favor, with confidence and without fear. It's a terrible thing to pray for God and feel so bad about yourself and so bad about your life and so separate from God that you think he wouldn't answer. It's a terrible place to be. To feel more overwhelmed by your imperfections than by God's love. The Bible said, I've not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, the knowledge of God's love that gives you a sound mind. The Bible says, perfect love casts out all fear. When we come to pray, God wants you to feel perfect love. Not perfect condemnation, not perfect doubt, not perfect fear, like I shouldn't be here, I shouldn't answer. God's not going to answer because I'm not perfect. No, this high priest has entered into the high place, not because you aren't, not because you are perfect, but he entered that place of heaven because you are imperfect, to get the answer for you. Now, that doesn't mean we trample God's grace. We ignore God's grace. We live as evil and as sinfully and as willfully as we can. Of course not. Of course not. You practice righteousness. You know, the other day, I went out surfing, and even though I'm an older man, I keep practicing to be a better surfer. I don't go out and practice to be a worse surfer, to fall, to wipe out. I practice to be better. You know, no matter what you do, I'm sure you're practicing to be better. We're practicing our faith. We're not practicing unrighteousness. That's how you can have confidence before God, because you know what you're practicing. No one can deceive you. You can't hide it from yourself, and you can't hide it from God. So practice what you believe. Practice loving God, serving God, walking in his will, obeying him, trusting him. It's powerful. And we'll receive mercy, that we may receive mercy for our failures and find his amazing grace in time of need. Time of need. Sometimes I feel like when I'm at my weakest, it's when I have my greatest needs. And that's when God wants to show up. My extremity is God's opportunity. When I'm at my worst, God's at his best. I just want to speak this to you. So there will even be times where God will give you a scripture. So in this friendship, God wants to speak. I want you to understand that prayer is not just about you going on and on and on. There's a whole other passage of scripture in Matthew, that sixth chapter, where it says that the people that don't know God, they babble, they say prayers, they repeat things over and over and over again. They don't pray heart to heart. Don't be like the hypocrites. They're playing a big show. We pray to God because we really want to hear. We really want to know. But there's a time, even in the best relationships, where you have to keep your mouth quiet and listen. And that's the other side to prayer. This is why we're going to be talking next about solitude, how we need to spend time to hear God's voice. There will be a time where God will give you a scripture as a confirmation for an immediate need. God wants to speak to you, give you a scripture, give you a word, give you a confirmation. God speaks through spirit-to-spirit communion. We talk about that a lot in this church because it's important that you know my sheep hear my voice and they know me. Friendship. It is through the scriptures and the Holy Spirit we see through the veil between God and man and heaven and earth. God will pierce that. God will pierce the veil between heaven and earth, the natural world and the spirit realm, with his word to speak to you. Almost all the time, God will quicken a scripture out of the Bible so you know it's his will rather than some random thought. I love this about God. God, we pray, then we listen till we hear his voice clearly. It's going to take some time. It's going to take some time. Take time with God. We're going to be talking about that. If I could ask one prayer to be answered, it would be that I hear God's voice. God is light, and in him there's no darkness, not even the slightest shadow of turning. James 1:17, there's no darkness in God. He's only going to lead you to good. There's one prayer that I could pray that I would hear his voice. But can we pray it together this morning? Let's just pray and say, Heavenly Father, I come before you. And so many things, say it with me, and so many things have blocked your voice. But I receive Jesus and his work on the cross for the forgiveness of my sins, that I might hear your voice. And Lord, I ask you that I might walk in your will as I hear your voice, your promises, your word, as they illuminate my steps and draw me closer to you. Lord, your voice is where my blessings lie, and I pray in Jesus' name that I receive him and hear your voice. I believe God wants you to hear his voice today. Even a sermon, you know, preaching the gospel, sitting, watching this broadcast, like in a sense, God always sent his prophets, God always sent his pastors and his teachers into there. Their job was to help people hear God's voice when they were struggling. And I pray today that your struggle would end, that you would hear God's voice. We love you. We hope to see you soon. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for your support. We want to continue to get this word out. I wish I can tell you that it doesn't take finances, but it does. And my Bible tells me that those who give, it will be given back to them, pressed down, shaken together, running over. God is not mocked. What a man sows, that he shall also reap. He who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. You cannot outgive God. Don't ever fear to be generous to give to God's house, because God will reward you openly for what you've given or prayed in secret. We love you. Have the best day. Talk to you soon. How
to think.